I'd like, first of all, to offer my good wishes to the Jesuit community here at Spring Hill, and indeed to you all for the feast that we commemorate today. All the saints and blessed of the Society of Jesus include well over 40 canonized saints and over 130 blessed, in other words, beatified members of the Society. This is an extraordinary testimony to the vitality of the Society of Jesus at the service of the Church, and as exemplified here in Spring Hill College, the spring of the Lord, the spring of the Lord's heart on the hill of Calvary, where your mission statement focuses on cura personalis, a care for the spiritual, social, and intellectual growth of each person in understanding the beauty of creation, the dignity of life, the demands of justice, and the mystery of God's love. In many ways, these areas are those that the Church has been focusing on throughout her entire history. And these are just some of the saints that I've been speaking of. Holy Father Ignatius, St. Francis Xavier, Francis Borgia, Stanislaus Kostka, Edmund Campion and Robert Southwell from my part of the world, and companions, martyrs of Christ in England, so a bit below us in the border, St. Aloysius Gonzaga, John Berkman, St. Paul Miki, sorry, this thing's flashing, St. John Ogilvy, martyr of Christ in Scotland. We had to have all of them till we got to there, most importantly. So, at the Synod of Bishops last month, the Synod of Bishops aroused significant interest in the international media. Passions did indeed swirl as members grappled with very fundamental issues, and we still await the final document from the Synod in English. As I noted in the publicity for this lecture, we are all passionate about some things. I'm not sure what your local baseball team is, but I do know what it was when I was in Boston for a while. Are we passionate about the Church? I have entitled this lecture, A Church of Passion and Hope, really as a response to Pope Francis's call to the new evangelization. After some opening remarks, I have three major points. The first calls attention to passion with a small p, in the sense of what we, when we are passionate about something. The second looks at passion with a large p, in terms of the Paschal mystery, a reality at the heart of all our lives, and therefore at the heart of the Church to which we belong. The third part section focuses on hope, a grace gift of the Holy Spirit, the true desire of our hearts, and a source of energy and vitality in our Church. Lastly, I will share with you, a wee bit monkey-faced, some of the fruit of my own research, which has resulted in this book, entitled A Church of Passion and Hope, but with a rather more lengthy subtitle. I didn't think I could really come and just talk to you about my book. It seems so utterly pretentious to do that. So it follows on, as it were. So to my opening remarks. In only 7 weeks, we shall be celebrating Christmas, the feast of the incarnate Lord, the incarnate Word, brought to birth amongst us in Christ Jesus. In him, divine life and human life were inseparably united. He is, as our creed maintains, consubstantial with the Father with regard to his divinity, and consubstantial with us with regard to his humanity. In Christ, God is seen as irrevocably committed to human persons. Irrevocably committed. The incarnation is one of the most striking contemplations in the spiritual exercises of Saint Ignatius. It encapsulates the Ignatian understanding of the universe, the Trinity, and Christ himself. It is a microcosm of Ignatius's theological understanding. It begins the second week of the spiritual exercises, as many of you may know who are involved in these the Ignatian programs here. In this contemplation, the retreatant is asked to imagine the Trinity, as it were, in conversation, the left-hand side there, looking down on the world and discussing the process of salvation. They look down to see the world, human beings laughing and crying, being born and dying, and going about every other human activity. And the second person, the Son, is to come to be one with us. In Christ, God's love becomes present in our midst. Emmanuel, God with us. Ignatius then asks us, having pondered that, to ponder the meeting between Mary and the angel Gabriel on the right-hand side there, that icon. In Our Lady, we see the fullness of a human response to God. One young woman across an entire history of Israel, one young woman alone says a full yes to God. The grace that Ignatius asks for us to ask for in this contemplation and throughout the whole of the second week of the exercises is the grace of an intimate knowledge of our Lord who has become a human person for me, so that I may love him more and follow him more closely. This intimate knowledge is crucial. It is not merely an intellectual knowledge, what in theological terms we might describe as an epistemological knowledge. It's not just of the mind. It is that. Ignatius knows no division between head and heart. He would think that an absurd reality when we speak about that sometimes. So it is of the intellect. But it's more than this. It is a knowledge of the heart, an affective knowledge as well, and the emotions. But it's more than that as well. It's intellect and it's heart, but it's more. It's also a knowledge of one's experience, an existential knowledge. But it's even more than that. It is, at its deepest level, an apprehension at the deepest level of our being. Again, what in theological terms we say an ontological knowledge. So it's a knowledge of the whole person. That's what Ignatius is asking us to pray for, that kind of intimate knowledge. And what is that, that apprehension at the level of our being? It is of God's passionate commitment to each one of us. This is the primordial reality that Ignatius is concerned that we should understand. God's passion for us. Because how can we be passionate about God or about the church unless the reality is that God has shown us how by being passionate about us first? So, because I think this is so important, we have a slide there on it. So an intimate knowledge is intellectual, affective, existential, and ontological of that reality of God's passionate commitment to each one of us. So with those opening remarks, let us move to passion with a small p. Because it is this most profound apprehension that is the source of true passion, that intimate knowledge of God at the source of our being. This intimacy with Christ fueled Ignatius's passionate commitment to the church. He was concerned to promote what he called sentir cum ecclesia, a certain thinking, judging, and feeling with the church with a creative and passionate fidelity. The very term sentire is not an easy one to translate. Literally, it is more than just being favorably disposed toward the church. It is to be engaged at that deep level of the intimate knowledge of Christ. So to think and feel with the whole of one's being, intellect, heart, experience, and the very depth of one's being with the church. It is to be willing to grow in communion with the church. This seemed to involve, for Ignatius, a growth in being at one with the church, not just as a matter of loyalty, but also with an effective collaborative communion with the hierarchy of the church. Such a disposition recognizes that not only every baptized member is a member of the church, but that the differing levels of the hierarchy of the church are also part of that self-same church as baptized members of that church. It involves an attitude that recognizes and embraces all the life-giving forces within that collaborative communion. Ignatius loved the church because he loved Christ. Pope Francis loves the church because he loves Christ. Ignatius recalled that Christ had guaranteed that his spirit would be with the church until the end of time. And Ignatius often uses the term spouse and mother, two very intimate terms, to describe the relationship of the individual with the church. It is to suggest that the one and the same spirit is behind both the hierarchical church and the most intimate personal experiences that we ever have, namely that of mother, we all have mothers, and that of spouse. Some of us have spouses. As Father Kolvenbach, the previous Jesuit general, reminds us, and I quote, Ignatius looks on the church as a whole, of which nothing can be ignored, neither its ecclesiastical hierarchy, nor the rest of its members, neither its charismatic expression, nor its canonical discipline, neither its holiness, nor its sinfulness, unquote. This is a love for the church, which, as I indicated previously with regard to that contemplation on the incarnation, a love for the church which is not just intellectual or affective, but encompasses all of that, reaching to the depths of our very being. It is to recognize within the church, by the grace of faith, the source of life, which is the presence of Christ. Love of Christ goes with love for the church and needs to be expressed in concrete acts. It's important to note that this passionate commitment has absolutely nothing to do with triumphalism. Rather, it is most authentically expressed by the flowering of humility within members of the church and the recognition of the need for ongoing conversion. Such a disposition is made concrete in the compassionate service of others. The theologian Hans Urs von Balthasar, who, as Matthew indicated, is one of my one of the theologians I work most with, in an essay he wrote on the nature of the church, asked a very provocative question. He said, "Who is the church?" Now, his own answer to the question emphasizes that, and I quote, "To frame the question in this way is to presuppose that the church is someone. In other words, a person," unquote. Balthasar sees the church not merely as an institution like other institutions, but as a person, because she is, to use St. Paul's great analogy, Christ's body. The church is the mystical body of Christ, and this body has a center of consciousness that resides in the head, who is Christ. The body forms together with the head one being. That is, the church is a person only by grace of the head, who is Christ. Therefore, in response to the question, who is the church, Balthasar gives the reply, the church is Christ living on. The church is Christ living on. This insight is not merely a pertinent theological assertion, but the foundation upon which we stand as a communion in Christ's body. It has radical implications for the life and conduct of those of us who are members through baptism, who are called to passionate commitment and compassionate witness. And it's my experience that this kind of passionate love is something both recognized and esteemed, particularly by young people today. It is something they search for, and in places where they find this, they wish to belong. By contrast, a lukewarm or cynical relationship with the church they find very unattractive. A significant difficulty arises when individuals see themselves over against the church and in conversations speak of the church in terms of the institutional structure, which has nothing to do with them. Failing to recognize the presence of Christ therein. So we move to the direct dimension of passion with a capital P, the Paschal Mystery. The struggle of Christ for the salvation of human persons, as Ignatius understood this, is the struggle of the church. It is revealed most clearly in the Paschal Mystery. In this redemptive act of Christ's passion, death, and resurrection, the love of our triune God is made known, a love that reaches into the depths of death for the salvation of human beings. The Paschal Mystery stands at the very center of Christian faith and is the primordial revelation of who God is in God's very self and in relation to human persons. Within the Passion, within the Paschal Mystery, God also hides in the horror of death. This is, as Balthasar reminds us, a paradox of revealedness in hiddenness, of the glory of God in degradation, of the fullness of life emerging through the brutality of death. In the great struggle in and through death to resurrection, God heals the wounds of sin and division in humanity. St. Paul came to interpret and to symbolize the profound contradiction that lies central to all human history, primarily as a continual struggle, a struggle not between human beings, but about human beings and the very destiny of human life. Ignatius brings this to our attention in the spiritual exercises. And I think this is really, again, a very important point to underline. It's a struggle about the very destiny of human life, what it is to be human. Because, as Ignatius reminds us, the enemy of our human nature is constantly trying to pull us to non-being, that we be not human. The definitive victory of redemption has been won by Christ. At the same time, his redemptive work continues in our world, in and through the church. But how is the church to be a true reflection of Christ in this struggle? What about when the church appears to be divided, polarized, and at enmity within its own members? In our contemporary society, when the church has been humiliated and vilified by public scandal, many seem paralyzed by grief and cynicism. When mourning abounds and when the grievous sin of a minority seem to obliterate the memory of the compassionate, faithful service of the dedicated majority, how is the face of Christ to be seen within the church, within ourselves? I suggest that our tradition may help us here. St. Paul, St. Ignatius, and Balthasar are all convinced that the ongoing conversion of all members is necessary for the health and vitality of the church. Pope Francis has been saying the same thing as he calls us to prayer and conversion and proclaimed a year of mercy. I sometimes say to my students, for example, when you go to the sacrament of reconciliation, as occasionally they might do, do you have a sense of the reality that this is not just about you and, as it were, your right relationship with God, but that you bring life to the body? You bring life to the body. And I think that's really important for us to have a feel for. And I'll say more about that in a minute. But for them, for my students, it was a revelation unto the Gentiles. Because they thought, oh no, I go to confession, I get rid of my sins, etc. The fact that it might have a communal dimension, they had, as it were, not realized. And I think in many ways it is for us to reappropriate that. Against the subtext of a church in struggle, we can pray for enlightenment. We know from our own experience how easy it is for us to become ensnared by things which draw us away from God. There is therefore an ongoing need for purification in our lives, not just of our reason and our will, but also of the very spirit within us. Such purification is vital, not just, as I said, for the individual, but so that the body of Christ, the church, might be healthy also. The well-being of the church and the truth and integrity of her living depends on the way in which we are faithfully living in Christ. In the words of a Jesuit philosopher, Canadian, we must be persevering in being attentive, intelligent, reasonable, responsible, and loving. It's Bernard Lonergan. So, but how is that in practice? Well, this means living a life of ongoing conversion. And it inexorably means coming into confrontation with our own very human temptations to independence and self-aggrandizement. You know, building up my own wee empire, whatever my own wee empire may consist of. And they tend to vary, but they generally have, you know, we all have acquisitiveness. In some ways, I think we sort of have a relationship with squirrels, not just because there's a lot of them in Toronto, but we sort of hoard away things in one way or another. The fruit, though, of prayerful, purified living is a real humility that is able to put a good construction on the words and actions of others. Because the more we have a sense of ourselves as truly loved by God, and as Pope Francis says, we can all stand up there and put our hands up to the fact that we are all sinners, but that we are deeply loved by God and called to an ever deeper sense of what that means. Then we are able to clearly and openly and receptively engage with others and to put a good construction on what they have to say. If you think about it, it's actually related to what we call the presupposition of the spiritual exercises. Since I don't know so many people here, I have met William only today, but I will take William as my little example. I'm sure he will forgive me. If I engage with William, and from this point of view, and I say, well, I know what William's going to say about this, because William always says that. So immediately I'm closed to anything William might say, because I know already. That's very different from coming to an engagement with William in terms of thinking, William is trying to say something that is good. My responsibility is to be open to the good William is trying to say. Can you see how very different those positions are? Well, this growth in our own conversion and that sense of a purification, a growth in humility, which isn't to be like Uriah Heep, I'm ever so humble I am, but is to be, in a sense, able to stand in the sense of who we are, with the gifts that God has given us that we offer to be used. Then we are so much more open to others, and our hearts are larger. It is also, this way is also to enter into Christ's work and his way. I mean, have you ever thought, what was so attractive about Jesus that people just got up and followed? And I'd like to, I've often pondered this, and I think part of it was, there was a deep love for people, a deep integrity of person, and a deep humility, such that he was at ease with who he was, and had the openness then to who he encountered. Always the final hermeneutic, the final, as it were, interpretive key in this way of following is the cross, without which there can be no resurrection. We know that along this way of our life, we embrace also in our lives, the reality of the passion. Suffering is an inevitability in every life, and the cross. But it's how we deal with that, how we come to that, and how we, as it were, let it be integrated within us. At the same time, when we act in this way, as I've said, we contribute to the life and health of the church and the redemptive work of Christ. I remember I was I was in Ireland, in Dublin, in 2012 for the Eucharistic Congress. Well, actually, I was there for the Theological Symposium before. And then, well, they brought me all that way. They asked me if I'd also talk at the Congress, which I did. And I can remember I had to get from one place to another very fast. So I caught a cab, which isn't my normal way of going on. I like to walk if I possibly can, or catch a bus. Anyway, the taxi driver, as Irish taxi drivers are, was very chatty. And so he was asking what I did, etc. And we got to talking about the Irish church. And he said, you know, really, I just don't know what to do. He said, you know, this happened, it was so bad. And, you know, everybody's so against the church now. And I don't know what to do, etc., etc., etc. And I said to him, but I really believe the way we live can help the church. So I said, even small acts of kindness in a day bring life to the body. And I think that's helpful to have a feel for, because you know how it is. If you're not a morning person, now actually I am a morning person, but I have community members who are totally not morning people, you know, that would want silent breakfasts to be back. But they grit their teeth, as it were, and attempt to be polite. Sort of, well, you know, any smile that you can give to someone, that's the smallest thing. But you know how it is, you smile at people and it's so people smile back. That even that small thing brings life to the body of the church. So there's no one who can't help the church be healthy if we are living a life, our lives, according to our Christian calling. Now, of course, the obverse is the true as well. If I'm not doing that, I am diminishing the life of the church. So I think it's important we have a feel for we can do something. We don't have to be paralyzed. We can contribute to this life. So to hope. I thought this was a nice wee picture for hope. The reality of hope, I would suggest to you, is always a gift of grace and is dependent upon the inspiration of the Spirit of God. It is, in essence, some realization of the passionate, loving commitment of God to human persons and the action God takes on our behalf. God continues to work in our world and in the church, even when this is imperceptible to us. Now, at the end of the spiritual exercises, you have this contemplation called, well, it has a heretical title, I have to say. It's called the contemplation to attain the love of God. Well, we don't attain as though it's all by our own efforts, but anyway. Within that, it's a whole series of points, and one of these speaks about praying about our God who is laboring for us. And I think this is really very important. Ignatius did not waste words. Laboring sounds like a laborer, and I think that's what Ignatius meant. You know, it bespeaks sort of real heavy physical labor, sweat and toil. Because he wants us to have a feel for the fact that that's how God is working on our behalf. I mean, clearly it's analogously, because we haven't got the terms that we cannot describe God. We strive after expressions. But this sense of a God working for us, and the indication is that God is working hardest where we see least. And you look around the world, where does it seem where perhaps God is most absent, or goodness is most absent? There God is working most. And the same in our own lives, in those areas that we find most difficult to bring to the Lord, those areas where we feel we will never improve or overcome something, there God labors most for us. And that is a source of hope for us, I suggest. This understanding of our working God. And as we share in the relationship between Christ and the church, we're brought to a deeper union with God and drawn into a more profound participation in and personal embodiment of the mission of the church. The gift of God's grace and love is consistently given to the church across all generations, and when recognized, is a rich source of hope. It's a gift that abides within the church despite any sinfulness on the part of individual members. Another important hopeful recognition is the tension that exists at the heart of our Christian endeavours, where the Spirit of God speaks through the experience, our individual discernment, but where this also needs to be ratified in relation to the body, namely the church. This communal dimension, in many ways, we have lost sight of. And this is a creative tension between the freedom of the Spirit operating both in the individual and in the authoritative voice of the church. Our difficulty so often comes, we want to resolve this one way or the other. It's part of our unwillingness to live with our own limitations and the fragmentary nature of human existence, the place where the cross truly touches our lives. When we begin to see that this place of tension is also a place of creativity and a place that deepens our own human integrity, then this too is a reason for hope. Because actually tension is a healthy word, and tension is at the heart of Ignatian spirituality. And if you think about it, we constantly live in tension. Our whole bodies are held in tension. That's the way we were created. You know, if your sort of liver goes askew, it throws other things out too. If your, I did chemistry and physics, so my biology is somewhat limited. If your spleen gets inflated, can a spleen get inflated? Anyway, then that clearly is something, well, poor father and whatever your present circumstances are, you know, clearly indicate we are held in tension. Hope is also closely related to joy. And real joy is something that can coexist with suffering. It has nothing to do with mindless optimism. The source of our joy is not in ourselves, but in the reality of God's definitive victory in Christ and the continued outpouring of the Spirit in the redemptive mission of Christ. This gives our hope a sense of the future and not just of the present. Hope thus becomes the certainty of this irrevocability of God's love, operative in individual lives and corporately in the life of the church. The love of Christ impels us. This cri de coeur, this cry from the heart, from St. Paul, is a helpful reminder of the focus for our living and activity as hope-filled men and women who are part of the church. Love alone makes us credible witnesses to our faith. Not our love manufactured by our own efforts and will, you know, I will love, but the love of Christ deeply rooted in his relationship with the Father and poured out by the Spirit upon us, into our hearts to overflow to others. It's this Trinitarian love which is the heart of Christian hope. It is the beauty of this love that it calls forth our diverse vocations to marriage, priesthood, religious life, and so much more, that inspires all our activity, and that communicates through our joyful witness the eternal hope of the gospel and the reconciliation that God so desires for our fractured world. It is the love of God in action, in the person of Christ, which opens our hearts and minds to the reality of intimacy with our God. It is from this depth of Trinitarian intimacy that we draw the resources for realistic hope and a credibility of love for all with whom we live and work. It is the imperious nature of this love that it has the power to draw us beyond the destructive, political, polarized struggles with which we all too readily engage. And the gentleness to disarm even those who have grown hardened. And it can lead us to seek what is common to every vocation in the church, that intimacy with Christ and a sharing in his mission. So just to bring in then the wee book before I conclude. This is it in its cover. As I say, it's got this slightly longer title, The Formation of an Ecclesial Disposition from Ignatius Loyola to Pope Francis and the New Evangelization. Publishers wanted Pope Francis on it somewhere. He actually forms a major part in it, but he had to be on the cover, according to that. These elements of passion, hope, and love, as I've outlined them, are also key characteristics of what I've identified as an Ignatian ecclesial disposition. Now, this book is going to be released in the US on November the 19th. As I say, that subtitle is quite a mouthful. It's got four sections, and in its first section, it begins by identifying what I have called the Ignatian ecclesial disposition. What was it in Ignatius's life, conversion, study? I thought you might like to see Ignatius as a student. That led to his particular desire to think and feel with the church. And the first three chapters, in a way, unpack an answer to this question. The first chapter focuses on a rarely identified part of the spiritual exercises, namely the rules for thinking, judging, and feeling with the church. There are 18 rules, and I've entitled that chapter Rules to Free or Oppress, because, you know, rules, we have a sense, rules sound authoritarian. Authoritarian is definitely no-no. Rules must be no-no also, so perhaps we just ignore it. Then there is what I have termed, I then pass on to consider the major Ignatian texts. So the spiritual exercises as a whole, the autobiography of Ignatius, the constitution, spiritual diary, and letters of Ignatius. And finally, for that section, the third chapter identifies some key elements of the Ignatian disposition. And what might they be? Well, an intimacy with Christ, which you're probably not surprised about now, you've heard the first part of my talk. Trinitarian awareness, which of course one leads to the other. A view of the graced human persons, and that's why I talked about the presupposition of the exercises, the good in the other. The importance of discernment and a certain mysticism of service. A service that is willing to embrace the cross. Why? Not for any kind of glorification of suffering, but a realization that suffering is part of life, suffering is the way Christ went, and a recognition that it may well be part of what we need to face. But the second section, I'll go on because time is moving on. The second section deals with two historical exemplars, and here we come back almost to the saints and blessed of the Society of Jesus. This one is one of my favorites, actually. When I entered religious life, my order still took names, and I quite fancied taking a PFR. But there was already somebody in the community who was called Sister Peter. So then I said, well, I wouldn't mind being Sister Habakkuk or Sister Stylites. Now, Habakkuk being an Old Testament prophet, and Saint Stylites, what was most famous for, standing on a pillar for a considerable number of years. Anyway, because my birthday happened to be a feast of the Society of Jesus, I was allowed to keep my own name because nobody fancied calling for Habakkuk or Stylites. So this is St. Pierre Fabre, canonized last year by Pope Francis, an early companion of Ignatius. And I have a chapter on him really showing how he exemplifies the Ignatian ecclesial disposition. And I'm just looking around my audience in terms of, I was thinking I might read you one or two extracts, but I think given who we are, I'll just read one, because I think it's really very interesting. Alongside all those alongside all those elements that I indicated the Ignatian disposition, each of the characters that I look at have also two particular characteristics and flavors in the way in which they express this disposition. And interestingly enough, St. Pierre Fabre, one of his is an ecumenical one. Now, what you have to know about him is he was involved with the debates with the reformers at the Council of Ratisbon. He would have gone to the Council of Trent, but he died en route to it. He was in Rome at the time. And at his involvements with these reformers, he also had a spiritual ministry. So in other words, he took part in all these debates, and then out with those debates, he also heard confessions, gave spiritual direction, etc., etc. But he had a very interestingly open outlook. So all the difficulties that he was aware of in these debates, etc., he took to prayer. Here he received an indication of the importance of praying for key figures in the religious conflicts of his times. He saw these men as having grave responsibilities, and his compassion for them was stirred. He said, I quote, "I felt great fervor as eight persons became present to me, along with the desire to remember them vividly in order to pray for them without taking notice of their faults. They were the Sovereign Pontiff, the Emperor, the King of France, the King of England, Luther, the Grand Turk, Bucer, and Philip Melanchthon, that came about through experiencing in my soul how severely these men were judged by many. As a result, I felt for them a certain kind of holy compassion, accompanied by a good spirit." Now, this is an extraordinary ecumenical spirit of the time. He was praying for Pope Paul III, well, you might think, yes, he would be praying for the Pope, Charles V, the Holy Roman Emperor, Francis I, King of France, Henry VIII, who in a sense had really undermined the church in the England, Martin Luther, Suleiman I, a Muslim, Martin Luther and Philip Melanchthon, along with Luther, leading lights of the Reformation. And notice, he prays for them and their good. He doesn't pray against them and for their downfall. He brings them before the love of God, which embraces all human beings. That is an extraordinary ecumenical and interfaith awareness in the 16th century. And I would suggest to you that is, as it were, an outworking of this ecclesial disposition. Now we come to somebody who I must spend a little bit of time with. This is Mary Ward. Why we must spend a little time with her, she's my foundress. The Venerable Mary Ward. She lived during the 16th and 17th centuries, respectively. Oh, sorry, during the latter part of the 16th and into the 17th century, amid a time of great turbulence for the church. And in the chapter that I give to her, I examine the outworking in her life in terms of the severe persecution that there was in her country. And we see the feminine dimension of this ecclesial disposition. Central to her life and writings is that preeminent desire both to find the will of God for her and to faithfully live this out. And that's very reminiscent resonant with Ignatius. And we can see that within her, one of the ways in which the particularity of the living out of this in her life was the clear sense of a process of discernment. She discerns vocation to religious life as a child in an England that no longer has any religious houses, so she needs to leave her country. She goes to the poor Clares because she's drawn to contemplative life, so she has to leave her country, go abroad to Saint-Omer, the most austere order of its kind. She learns through an illumination by the Spirit of God that she's not to be a poor Clare, but something good, what God willed. So then she starts setting about praying for this something good that is what God willed. Then she has to leave the poor Clares, as I say, knowing that she's not to be one, goes back to England, begins helping in England in the spiritual and corporal works of mercy, helping to prepare people for the priests, very secret work, very dangerous work, at a time when people could be executed. So she then realizes that this something good that God wills is something that's more to the glory of God. She has this, what we call the glory vision. So all the time she's building on her discernment, and each time she's praying on what she receives, until finally in 1611, she has this understanding that there's something good, which is what God wills, which is more to the glory of God, is to take the same of the Society of Jesus. She understood that as to take the constitutions of the Society of Jesus, an active apostolate for women at a time when there was no active apostolate for women, which would mean no enclosure. All women religious were enclosed. She wanted governance by a woman superior general. There was no order where that was the case. So, as you can imagine, she kind of fell foul of the authorities of her time. But what's very interesting is that her clarity of heart and mind that enabled her to live the tension of being faithful both to the illuminations that she had received and the church of her time, which could not envisage active women religious. Her insight also into the nature of forgiveness also echoes much of Pope Francis's focus on the importance of mercy. And there's just one little thing I'd like to read you about her. Mary was enabled to live without bitterness or resentment. And part of the reason for this can be traced to an illumination in 1625 when she received, as she said, from our Lord so much light and knowledge regarding the forgiveness of enemies that ever afterwards she cherished a tender affection for all who wronged her and was in the habit of calling them friends. In this ability to forgive, Mary clearly shows the intimacy of her relationship with Christ. And as John Paul II stated, Christ did not fail Mary Ward. No matter how great were the difficulties which she had to undergo, ill health, dangerous journeys, imprisonment, above all being misunderstood even by important people within the church, in all this she never lost her trust and good humour. And look how fruitful her life has been, all because she built her whole life on the friendship of Christ. She was a pilgrim of hope, whose abiding treasure was the life of grace within her, from which she drew energies for a task, which because of its dynamism and enterprising spirit seemed unusual and inexplicable to many of her contemporaries. But here we are, 400 plus years later, and still going. So, I'm coming to the end. I think I'll just jump over. There's a chapter, in the third section I deal with two figures, Colonel Henri de Lubac, a French Jesuit, and somebody more familiar to you, Colonel Avery Dallas. As I say, I think I better leap forward a bit. The last section is the Ignatian Ecclesial Disposition and the Contemporary Papacy. And there are three chapters in that. Contextual background, centrality of Christ, and the ecclesial disposition and the new evangelization. So in the contextual background, of course, I look at Pope John, St. John Paul II. I thought those two pictures gave a real sense of across his papacy. And then Cardinal Joseph Ratzinger, and then Pope Benedict XVI, now Pope Emeritus Benedict, and Pope Francis. And in a sense, I think this picture in many ways also encapsulates not just the sense of outreach, but also that outreach is at the heart of the new evangelization. So I'll jump over this. In conclusion, if I can find myself. I also spend some time on the Synod of Bishops, which I was both honored and humbled to be a part of in 2012, and just as it relates to the new evangelization. So in conclusion, the church is more than a mere context within which the human person comes to experience God. It's not just an external organization or a structural framework in which we set ourselves. Nor is it merely a body to which we have some loose association and of which we can be highly critical. Primordially, the church for us, as for Ignatius, is the visible embodiment of Christ himself. The call of Christ to the church today is, as Pope Francis continues to remind us, a call to a passionate, loving encounter with Christ our Lord. It is a call to commitment to his body, of which we are all members. In and through this twofold commitment, the passionate love of God flows into the church's mission, which is the redemptive work of Christ for the life of the world. The reality of the cross, which is a share in the passion of Christ, is an inevitable part of life within the church, which is, as we are, both sinful and holy. Yet this intimate loving union with Christ, which leads into the heart of the Trinity, is the source of our hope as individuals and communally as the church. It is the wellspring for the new evangelization. In a church of passion and hope, there is a beacon of light and life to illuminate a darkened world. Thank you. Father Tom Masika kindly gave a copy of my book to the to Pope Francis. He said he was sorry it wasn't a better photograph, because the Pope did have it in his hands and he was looking through it. But they all got so excited that this was as he was giving it to him. You may or may not have any questions, but would you like to buzz for a minute? Would that help? Oh, do you have that expression down here? Talk to one another for a minute, and then perhaps some questions. Sorry. Six.
Oh, yes. Should I ask them?
I'm happy to respond to any questions. I don't know how to have answers, but responses. Oh. Did I do something?
Go for it.
Oh, I really don't
want to. Oh, okay.
I was just, you made a comment about God laboring most for us in areas where he seems most absent. Mm. Would you talk about that a little bit more?
Certainly. The point, it's the third point of the Contemplatio, and it's speaking of God laboring, and I've always been struck by how very, the physicality of that, and I think it's very pertinent. It's very pointed and it's very well chosen. Ignatius doesn't waste his words, but it's to bring before us that sense of, and I would emphasize the seams, that it's as though it's related to the sense of there's a struggle about human beings. There's a struggle for the life of human beings. And you've got the enemy of our human nature, as Ignatius likes to call, trying to pull us into this whole area of non-being, and God continually offering love to grow into the fullness of our being. Different parts of, I mean, things that come to my mind are things like those parts of the Middle East at the moment, which are seeing such horrific violence. We say, well, what's? I mean, I know people are going, there's armies and there's bombs and all these sorts of things, but where is within all this anything that is good? And it's really the sense of Ignatius calls us to have a sense that because of this reality of God's passionate commitment to us, that must be where God is most drawn and most laboring. And from a distance, and certainly by media coverage, we don't see that. But I think where we get a flavor of it, when you receive reports of, for example, I was just thinking in terms of the Jesuit community in Homs and such, where of real goodness, of that sense of people sheltering other people, of a real concern to not just survive oneself, but of a reaching out that is at that deep level of a human acknowledgement and awareness. That's where I think we get glimpses of where, how, and where God is working there. But it is, it's like saying, it's like Calvary. Because that's where the glory of God is shown, in a dying man. And those weak gestures of love from the cross are part of what saves the world. So I think it's our openness to that. And it's, in a sense, it's asserting our faith in that. And that then begins to open our own hearts and minds to the possibilities that in our own suffering, in our own difficulties, there God labors most for us, but also to, in and through those times, strangely we can reach out to others. I have this kind of, perhaps it's this notion that actually I think we connect most with other people, not through our strengths, but through our freely acknowledged limitations. So for example, I can remember one time I always say everybody left me. We had a community over in Glasgow at one point during the time of my son, five of us. And one had to go back to England because she couldn't cope with the weather. One dropped dead in the post office, which was, I mean, it had a heart attack and went to God, but which was nice for her. But you know, that, so then there were three, it was kind of like 10 green bottles on the wall. And then what happened to the other one? Someone was taken for mission somewhere else. And then finally, the other member was made provincial. So I was left, as it were, on my own in this until you know we sorted out a different scenario. And I am not the most practically minded, as William knows, even in such a short acquaintance. So at one point I needed something as simple as a hammer, and I didn't have a hammer. And I really wanted something put up on the wall. So I went next door and we lived in this this kind of block of flats. It's in quite a poor area. And so I went next door, and that it was an easy sort of entree, you know, because people, I needed something. I wasn't going to give them something. I wasn't going to preach to them. I wasn't going to do anything. I actually was in need, and people responded to that. And that began quite a friendship. You know, so that's what I mean by I think we can reach. I think we make often really those connections through our limitations, because people can sometimes be put off by our strengths. Although, as I say, you know, when university insists that on our emails and such like they go out with all these. The bottom, your name, all these degrees and things, and it, you know. And I often say to people, but that won't cook a dinner. You know, all these degrees. So these sorts of things, you know, so you have to have a sense of balance in all this. Does that, that's a response. I don't know if that was helpful. Does anybody else have any questions? Yeah, oh, right.
I'm sorry.
No, it's okay, there's two of you.
This is a bit connected to what Jean was asking. And I'm not sure about the translation of that word labor, but I think it also connects to the question I wanted to ask you to speak a little bit more about your comments on non-human, the enemy of our human nature, trying to interfere with our, and it's a non-human movement. And then connecting that again with the laboring God. And I have always connected that with the image of a woman laboring.
Yes.
And the painfulness pregnancy.
Yes.
But that notion that you mentioned of non-human, that was very intriguing to me. I was just wondering if you could elaborate on that.
Yeah, I think I said non-being, but non-human would also work. It's a sense of it's like a major lie of the enemy of our human nature is you can manage all this on your own, and you only need to think of yourself. And that is a very enclosed, if you think about it, a very enclosed pathway. And it's a bit like a noose tightening. And that's in contrast to we were created as individuals in community. We don't exist for ourselves alone. I mean, it's true, you know, no man is an island, or woman for that matter, but it's more in that sense of our whole being is about relationship. And that's because we're made in the image of God. And God is relationship. The Trinity relates. The persons are one in their relating. So we're called to relationship. And the enemy wants to pull us away from that sense of relationship both with God and with one another. And that is to draw us into non-being, because our being is for God and others. And it's pulling us away from that, and that's why I say into non-being. Now, I have a student who just defended his doctoral thesis last week, who would give all this in very, very metaphysical terms, which very few of us would understand. But that's at the heart of it, it seems to me. Does that help?
It does, and it reminds me of what Pope Francis has said about the greatest movement of the enemy is that we close in on ourselves.
Absolutely.
And that we isolate ourselves, go in on ourselves.
Absolutely. You see, there's always that part. It's either a spiral inward or it's a movement outward. And it's a good sort of point of reference for discernment. You know, is this an inward move that actually is debilitating? Or is this an outward move, which in general is always energizing? Because it's bringing us back to true source.
And that laboring is an outward move, by the way.
Yeah, exactly.
You're
exactly.
Giving birth.
Exactly.
It out,
yes.
Not bringing it in.
Yeah. Thank you. I think that's helpful, because I think I need to bring those two images together. Because it's not that women can't be physical laborers, but it tends to be more men. But this is a better image for women. Thank you. Yes? Would you like?
I'm not Roman Catholic, and I was intrigued by your use of the word conversion.
Right.
Are you talking about a conversion that happens internally, constantly? Is that, or could you expound on your use of the word?
Certainly, yes. Conversion, the way I was using it, was ongoing conversion. So in a sense, you might recognize the word sanctification more. That might be more appropriate to your tradition, would it?
Maybe. Yeah.
Oh, right.
You would have done well with Saint with us.
Yes. Yeah. Well, I suppose, in a sense, a movement to deification involves conversion. Ongoing conversion, I think that's really what I was meaning. Because sometimes we can, this is perhaps where we have some differences with some of some other denominations, which focus very much on, I was converted on, whereas in a sense, and some people really may have that sort of, like Paul and the horse, or the fictitious horse. But he knew he had to have ongoing conversion. And it's that sense, we know in ourselves, it's like Paul in Romans 7, you know, we do the things we don't want to do. You know, we desire to be good, for want of a better way of putting it, and we're drawn more and more away. And that's why discernment and that real sense of coming to know ourselves, our own, what I say is, I think we're all diamonds, flawed diamonds. And our flaws may be a bit different, but we all have flaws. But once we know them more acutely, we can take measures to move, to catch the way in which the enemy is working earlier. Well, thank you very much for your attention. Oh.